Boom, jump scare edit. No special intro for today because the intro I originally filmed was so garbage that posting it would bring dishonor to my family. Pretend I had an amazing intro.
Hi everyone. Hi everyone, I'm Elmushterri and I'm never using that intro again. It's exclusive. Once again, sorry for disappearing. This is my final year of school before, hopefully, university, so I'm focusing more on that than anything. You may be able to tell, but just a note, I am sick and dying, and I will pass away at 2 p.m. tomorrow. That is not a suggestion. Anyways, today I'll be rewriting Rise of the Guardians per the request of the wonderful JJ Doe, who, by the way, redesigned the characters themselves on TikTok.
Look at them, babies!
May I just say to JJ that I am so appreciative of you. You've been here since day one, and you continue to provide really insightful comments on my videos. You're just a wonderful person to have all around. I like the fact that I know certain people in my little community, and I am happy to have you all.
You cannot escape.
Okay, so, Rise of the Guardians holds a really special place in my heart. I love the idea of magic in the mundane. Basically, taking everyday things that we attribute some kind of magic to, and sort of actually making them magical. I don't know if that made sense, but yeah, use your imaginations! The thing that's lacking in Rise of the Guardians was the focus. Is this about defeating Pitch, or getting kids to believe in the Guardians, or Jack's backstory, or what? Not to say that you can't do all of these things and pull it off, but I just don't think it was well executed. Is Pitch some kind of Guardian? He can't have come from nowhere, because according to Tooth, they were all somebody before they were chosen. So what was Pitch chosen for? Was he just born out of fear or whatever? Because humans can't come back from the grave without the Man in the Moon's choosing, so he must have chosen Pitch, but for what? Additionally, the ending was kind of lackluster, with the Guardians killing Pitch or like getting him dragged under a bed or whatever. So does fear not exist anymore? Like, don't get me wrong, I love the movie unconditionally, but we can acknowledge its flaws. So let's get into the redesigns, starting with our main Tumblr pretty boy Jack. So Jack Frost. I feel weird about his design. He's like supposed to be from the American colonies or whatever it was, and he died in 1712, I believe. I don't know if that's accurate though. I'm not gonna go research the American colonies. So being that this is like a pre-Victorian kid, why is he wearing a hoodie? You can argue that his style changed, but I wanna imagine him as a like a timeless child. Someone who doesn't change, or well, I guess that makes him a time child, but whatever. Note, I didn't like the style with which I drew Jack, so I tried again. I've been having issues with my style for a long time, and I'm sure a lot of you guys can sympathize if you're artists. I drew him 3 times before I finally settled on what I wanted him to look like. I gave him blue skin because, you know, like cold hypothermia and all that, and black hair, just for contrast with the glowy white jacket. Next up is the Tooth Fairy. Now disclaimer, I saw this mural art of Tooth in her human form, and I wondered why she was brown-skinned as a human but white-skinned as a guardian? Kinda sus, to be honest. In her concept art and in the books, you can kinda like vaguely see that she's based off of South Asian culture, so I decided to bring that back by giving her like an actually more accurate outfit, inspired by a form of classical Indian dance. I am not sure how to pronounce this, but I'll try. So this form of classical Indian dance is called Bharatanatyam. I'm probably saying it wrong with the American accent, but oh well. Honestly, I feel like Tooth's design in Rise of the Guardians is kind of like perfect. Just give her some clothes and that's all you need. Making the Tooth Fairy a hummingbird lady was like a stroke of genius on the part of the design team, to be honest. One thing I would change about Tooth's general thing is her hummingbird fairy assistants. I'd just make them full-on hummingbirds instead of weird hybrids because these do not look good. They're supposed to be cute, but they kind of just come off as uncanny, but alright. Next is Bunny. There's actually almost nothing I can say about his new design except for the fact that he's more punched in mine. He looks a little too human in stature in the original, so I just gave him that back curve that bunnies have. Otherwise, I made him slightly more green than blue so Jack's palette wouldn't look too much like his. Props to the Guardians crew for making Bunnymon perfect. I literally have nothing more to say. About North and Sandy? Perfect. I literally have absolutely nothing to add to these men. Making Santa a big muscular Russian man called Nicholas St. North was perfect, and making the Sandman a little circular dude, also a stroke of genius. Okay, last is Pitch. Pitch's design is... Okay, there's a lot to be improved upon. I will begin by saying this. Pitch's gown reminds me of something from my own culture. It's called the Dishdasha. And now that I've said the name, we can all acknowledge how funny it is and move on. Great, okay. In the summer, men in my country wear a white dishdasha, but in the winter, they wear gray or black, which is good because it ties into the whole pitch black Jack Frost sort of thing. Okay, let's talk about the ethics of making Pitch an Arab-coated dude for a second. Arguably, we as Arabs have been portrayed as villains for a long time. I think I'm sort of reclaiming it by not making him this caricature of evil Arabs, Jafar, and giving him actual modern Arab clothes. Besides, as an Arab, I find these clothes fetching. So, onto the story. It begins with Jack being pulled out of the icy river as a ghost by the man in the moon. He's having fun and all, but then he realizes he's dead. Then we skip to 300 years later, but instead of being around Easter time, it's around Christmas time instead. Just like a couple days before North has to have everything ready. Honestly, I don't know when Christmas time is. It's either the 24th, 25th, or 26th, and like one of them is called Christmas Day, and the other one is Christmas Eve, but I'm unfamiliar. It's better this way because now we can drive home the whole winter aesthetic for Jack and Pitch. The second thing we see is North preparing for Christmas. Basically, he's checking on all the toys and such and creating little ice sculptures and whatever in nearly the exactly same way as the movie. A Yeti comes in and tells North to go look at the globe. The lights, which indicate how many kids believe in the Guardians, are flickering. Then an apparition of Pitch Black appears. Pitch Black hasn't been seen in 1,000 years, so North gets worried. The apparition of Pitch goes onto the globe and disappears around South Asia. North uses an aurora borealis to summon the Guardians, and we get brief imagery of what the Guardians are doing, just like in the movie. So Bunny is hand-painting eggs, Tooth is zipping around and telling the fairies where they need to go to collect teeth, and Sandman is in his airship, which he only has in the books, distributing dream sand. They each have their own globes in their homes, but they're too preoccupied with their jobs to notice the flickering lights. We cut back to Jack, who is playing with the kids by making snow and stuff, but they still can't see him because they don't believe in Jack Frost. At some point, one of the kids brings up how Santa brought the snow or whatever, and Jack's like, "Santa didn't make the snow, I did!" So he's annoyed that after 300 years, nobody can see him, but they can see Santa and the Easter Bunny and all that. So we go back to the Guardians, who are all now in the North Pole. North is like, "I saw Pitch!" And Bunny's like, "No, we drove Pitch away 1,000 years ago, and fear levels have been at an all-time low these days. You should know better than to call me down here in December. Eggs take such a long time to paint." Obviously, I'm paraphrasing, I'm not writing a perfect script for this. And then North is like, "No, I saw him, and besides, Easter's not as important as Christmas." And those two, like, start fighting for a second like they do in the movie, and Tooth in the background is still doing her job, because she's a girl boss and all that. Sandman, who doesn't speak, is trying to get their attention, and then they see that the man in the moon is picking a new guardian. So North is like, "Hey, look, I told you Pitch is back." Then they speculate for a second about who the new guardian will be, and then boom, it's Jack Frost. And Bunny's like, "Jack Frost is a winter spirit. How is he gonna help destroy Pitch?" Anyways, we go back to Jack Frost, who's like vibing or whatever. Like in the movie, they drag him to the North Pole, and then they're like, "Hey, man in the moon shows you, you're a guardian now." And Jack's like, "Wait a minute. Wait a damn minute. Man in the moon brought me back to life 300 years ago and then literally ghosted me, and then now he's hiring me for a job that I didn't apply for." And Bunny's like, "Hey, that's exactly what Pitch said. See, look, we shouldn't trust Jack, he's just like Pitch." And North is like, "Yeah, shut up, man." And he talks to Jack personally for a little bit, and he's like, "Okay, so every guardian has a core value. Mine is wonder, Tooth's is memories, Bunny's is hope, and Sandy's is reflection. And they encourage those values by doing their job. So what's your core value?" And Jack's like, "Oh, I don't know, decline still." Then boom, conversation is ended because like Tooth is like, "Oh, hang on, I'm spider sensing that my palace is being attacked." So they head to Tooth's palace and it's been raided by Pitch, who's still there. So Pitch taunts the Guardians for a second and they're like, "Dude, I thought we got rid of you." And then Pitch is like, "No, you can't get rid of a Guardian unless nobody believes in them. And everybody believes in fear." And Jack is like, "Wait, he's a Guardian?" And then North is like, "He was a Guardian." Then Pitch comes over to Jack and he's like, "I feel like I've seen you before. But considering you're not one of the important people, I'll ignore you. But you're probably used to that." So Jack gets mad and Pitch leaves. Tooth gets upset because all of her tooth fairies are gone and so are the teeth that she's collected over the centuries. So like in the movie, she goes and sits next to the mural in her palace and Jack is like, "Why do you care that the teeth are gone?" And she says that they contain childhood memories and that she even had Jack's teeth. And then Jack is like, "Wait, I had a childhood?" And she's like, "Yeah, we were all somebody before we were chosen." And boom, Jack is like, "Okay, we need to find the damn teeth." Because he's still selfish at this point in the story. But then boom, Tooth's feathers begin to fall out because less people are believing in her instantly. Because kids around the world are waking up to find teeth still under their pillows. So then the same thing happens as it does in the movie. North is like, wait, I have an idea. What if we collected the teeth? And, you know, they do that. And it's a big funny montage of Jack and Bunny being competitive and having a rivalry, because Jack is a winter spirit and Bunny's a spring spirit and all that. And Jack keeps ruining spring. Yeah. I assume you've all watched the movie. Okay, so they're in some kid's house collecting teeth, and then Jack and Tooth run into each other. They have a sweet conversation about how Tooth has actually missed going out and collecting teeth herself. And then the other guardians come in, and they accidentally wake up a group of kids who are having a sleepover. So the kids are amazed and all that, because they can see everyone except Jack. So Jack gets upset and sneaks out the window while the guardians are still talking to these kids. So he's outside just walking around the street, and then boom, black misty thing starts chasing him. He gets chased through the city for a little while, but then the black mist turns into Pitch, and Pitch is like, damn, I just wanted to talk. And Jack's like, oh, so you're the ex-guardian. And Pitch is like, damn, ex-guardian, I should have known they'd demote me. And then Pitch paces around for a second, and he says, it's a shame what happened to you. Jack's like, what? And Pitch continues like, I could have stopped it if I was there, but I guess you wouldn't trust that coming from an ex-guardian. Just goes to show you that the man in the moon does make mistakes when it comes to choosing. Before Pitch can continue, Sandman appears and attacks Pitch with a golden sand whip. So Pitch grabs the sand whip and turns it black, and he's like, I haven't seen your sand in a while. I remember it took you a long time to copy mine. So now Jack is confused, because apparently Pitch is older than Sandy, and canonically Sandy is the oldest guardian. So Pitch disappears, and then Sandy sort of has a lot of explaining to do to Jack, but of course Sandy doesn't speak, so he uses his sand to make illustrations. Basically, the scene turns into sand art, or like sand 3D models, with the sand flowing into itself to make images on the screen. So, through using the sand, Sandy communicates that Pitch was jealous of the other guardians because they inspired children, but Pitch only ever scared them, so he turned evil. But the guardians drove Pitch away, causing him to disappear for 1,000 years. So Jack is like, if Pitch only scared people, why did the man in the moon choose him? And Sandy raises a question mark over his head. So Jack is like, what if the man in the moon is making the same mistake with me? And Sandy is sort of like, why don't you prove that he isn't? I don't know how he would communicate that in sand, but alright. So then we cut to a montage of the guardians working on Christmas because it's like 3 or 2 days before. It's just fun stuff. In this section, I would have it being about Jack in the North Pole messing with the Guardians, but also working kind of well with them, showing that he can be fun and responsible at the same time. Remember that, okay? That's gonna be a theme. Then, in the next sort of chapter thing, you'd see the different Guardians talking to each other. In the movie, it's implied that they're friends and colleagues, but haven't actually properly hung out with each other in centuries.
Guess who's been editing and just found out their mic stopped recording? Alright, bear with me till we get back to where my mic did record. For this bit, I'm just going to be using my iPad, so excuse the strange quality.
So this would give the chance for the Guardians to catch up with each other. You don't see a lot of Guardian combinations in the real movie, so these scenes would have Sandy and Tooth interact, Sandy and Bunny. For some reason, Sandy just didn't get much screen time in the original. Just a really happy chapter overall. Bunny begins to trust Jack enough to show him his home area, which is called the Warren. So yeah, it's gorgeous here, and it's not covered in snow. And here Jack begins to appreciate the things that aren't winter. Oh, and Tooth and North are also there, just saying. It's a nice scene between these three and Bunny where they're learning about how Easter works. But then North gets the feeling that something is wrong in the North Pole, and Sandman is the only one there. So the Guardians rush over to the pole, but Jack gets there first. He sees Sandman being attacked by Pitch. Pitch finds a moment to toss Jack the container of his teeth, and Jack gets selfish for a moment. He gets distracted holding onto the teeth, and that allows Pitch to shoot Sandy in the back, turning him into black sand. So the Guardians come in just as Sandy is turned into black sand. He dissolves into the air. Pitch says, pleasure doing business with you, Jack, and then he disappears. Then the Guardians see that Jack has his tooth file in his hands, and nobody else's. Immediately, Bunny jumps on the idea that Jack betrayed them, and he reverts back to saying that the Guardians should have never trusted Jack.
We should never have trusted you!
And the other Guardians sort of just don't have anything to say because honestly, they agree with Bunny. Like in the movie, Jack goes off in the snow to hide in shame, and he sees Pitch there. Pitch genuinely apologizes to Jack for framing him back there with the Guardians. He says he had to in order to get the Guardians off of Jack's side. So naturally, Jack is incredibly angry. He asks Pitch what his deal with him is, and why he's still jealous of the Guardians. And Pitch is like, jealous? Is that what they said? So eventually, Pitch encourages Jack to open up the box of teeth, and we get a flashback from Jack's life. So it's the same as in the movie. He's playing a game on the ice with his sister, which is a bad idea. And eventually, the ice cracks under his sister, but Jack uses his stick to move her out the way. but instead, he falls into the icy water and dies. In the movie, Jack gets super happy that he had a sister and he saved her, and it's super inspiring for him. But in my opinion, this shouldn't have been inspiring. It should have been pretty horrifying, because, you know, he died. You know what I mean?
So Pitch goes on to explain that because Jack and his sister weren't afraid to run onto the icy river, Jack died. So if they had basic instincts, they'd both be alive, and Jack would have grown up normally and such. Pitch says to Jack, "You deserved a normal life. All of the Guardians did." So then Jack asks Pitch how he even contributed as a guardian, and Pitch tells him he isn't the guardian of fear, he's the guardian of safety. It's just that his method of keeping people safe was by using nightmares, and giving them human instincts. Basically, like, you know how Jack, when he uses his fun powers, people's eyes light up with sparkles and they become more fun? Pitch does the same thing. He can induce fear in people like that. And he would have done, but the Guardians chased him off thousands of years ago. So Jack now sees Pitch's perspective, but that doesn't change the fact that Pitch killed Sandy and disabled Tooth. Which, by the way, short explanation time, the reason Pitch has gone for Sandy and Tooth in my version is because North and Bunny only have an impact once a year. So if Christmas doesn't happen, for example, loads of kids will stop believing in Santa, but that's a lot harder to do than taking out Tooth and Sandy because those two work daily. If one day goes by without kids finding coins under their pillow, they instantly stop believing in the Tooth Fairy. So Pitch is being tactical with who he's taking out to damage the Guardians. Jack is still mad about Pitch murdering Sandy, so he decides to fight him. Which isn't received well by Pitch, who was kinda hoping he and Jack could be friends. So yeah, they fight, and the fight ends up in Pitch's lair, where all the fairies were taken. Jack stops fighting Pitch and begins freeing all the fairies instead. He gets hurt while doing so, so the fairies carry him to the Guardians, North's house specifically. The fairies explain to Tooth what happened, because, you know, the fairies can speak to Tooth, and the Guardians decide to take Jack back in. Obviously, Bunny is still sore from the betrayal that he thinks happened. So now it's Act 3. The Guardians have accepted Jack back in, and the fairies are also back, so everything is kind of on track except for the fact that nobody is getting dreams. So the belief level has been decreased dramatically, but they're still surviving. Remember, if nobody in the world believes in you, and if you're a Guardian, you fade out of existence. The Guardians and Jack are currently working on fishing. The Guardians and Jack are currently working on finishing the preparations for Christmas, which is like, tonight-ish? Everything is going according to plan, and you get like a couple scenes of the Guardians interacting, but sort of somberly. It's the third act, so it's not lighthearted or anything. They're being very work-focused, and even Jack is focusing on the work for once. He just really wants to see Christmas go through perfectly, because there have been so many setbacks so far. Okay, cool. So Christmas is ready to go, and the Guardians get into the sleigh with North. They're about to start delivering gifts to kids, and they're like flying through the sky and everything, but then BOOM! Pitch appears. A fight scene starts up in the sky while the sleigh is zooming around, and Pitch has his nightmares with him and they're all attacking. Jack and Pitch separate from the fight, and they're fighting on their own now. Jack tries to convince Pitch out of destroying Christmas, saying that if nobody believes in the Guardians, they'll fade out of existence. And Pitch is just like, "They made their choice to be Guardians, and you made your choice not to join me." So they continue fighting. And then Jack goes back to the sleigh where he realizes it's all broken, and the Guardians are falling, except Tooth, who can fly. Jack spreads snow on the ground to prevent the Guardians from crashing, so now they have no sleigh, and no presents. It seems like it's all over, and North says that he did manage to save a couple presents, so Jack decides that they should at least deliver those. So they get into a house, and they put all these presents under the tree, and it's kind of a sad moment because these are the only presents they have. And we cut to the sun rising. The Guardians are just standing in the empty street and watching it rise. Almost immediately, they all become weaker. It starts with North because he's the one that Christmas centers around. He just becomes a regular old man and he has to use his sword as a cane. Then the other Guardians follow in losing their powers. Tooth loses her feathers in flight, for example. And Bunny starts shrinking into a regular rabbit. And unlike in the movie where small Bunny can still talk, this would be a lot more dark, because in my version, when Bunny begins to shrink, he actually turns into a regular bunny. He stops being able to talk, and he just sort of has those dead black eyes. So they've all lost their powers. All except Jack, of course, who never officially became a guardian. And remember, you only fade out of existence when nobody believes in you if you're a guardian, which is kind of one of the cons to the pros of being a guardian. You just constantly have to keep your work up. But then we cut to the house that the Guardians did manage to deliver the gifts to, and boom, it's those kids from earlier, the sleepover kids. They're ecstatic to have confirmation that Santa is real, and because Santa's real, so is the Tooth Fairy and so is the Easter Bunny. Basically, they're the only kids in the world who still believe in the Guardians, and they're the ones stopping the Guardians from fading out of existence completely. Then we zoom in on a bit of Pitch's nightmare sand on one of the gifts that was left over from the fight. The kid doesn't notice it and picks up the gift anyway. His hand touches the nightmare sand, and it starts to turn into Sandy's golden sand. The sand drifts away, and more sand starts to accumulate, and it's all flowing in one direction. Jack is walking around alone through the streets, and then he sees the sand. He gets excited and starts following the sand, flying as it turns bigger. He follows it, and it goes right into this giant sand airship in the sky that Jack has never seen before. He steps into it, and Sandy reforms. So Jack is extremely happy, and he's like, we gotta tell the others. And then Sandy turns around and sees his globe. Reminder, every guardian has a globe in their lair. And then he's like, you know, communicating through sand. What happened to the believers? And Jack is like, no time to explain, you gotta come with me, you have dreams to make. So these two soar through the sky, giving sleeping kids dreams about the guardians. Those kids wake up and then believe in the guardians, so, you know, boom, profit. Eventually, the guardians themselves, who are sort of having to walk home since they have no powers anymore, regain their powers all of a sudden, and then Jack and Sandy zoom past them and they're like, no way. They start following Jack and Sandy. North and Bunny probably do some rooftop jumping since they can't fly like Tooth. It's just a really happy scene of Sandy and Jack and the rest of the guardians creating dreams everywhere, zooming through the sky. Finally, they come to some street, and a bunch of kids are awake and staring at them outside. Basically, they all believe in the Guardians now. And then one of them points and is like, hey, look, it's Jack Frost! And Jack realizes that somebody has seen him. He looks over at Sandy and realizes that Sandy included him in the dreams that he's been giving to the kids. And then all the kids start waking up and coming into the street confused. And it's evident that every kid believes in Jack Frost now, because of the dreams. So then North begins a sort of speech about what Jack has done and how he's helped them. And he's sort of like, it's only right that we finally acknowledge what you are. So then in the middle of the street, North takes out a guardian book and then boom, Jack officially becomes a guardian. I imagine it's a cool glowy scene, like he even gets an Elsa-esque show yourself outfit. So cool, Jack is officially the guardian of fun. Alright, we cut to later and it's one of those scenes where one of the guardians has their hands over Jack's eyes. Then they take their hands off and Jack looks around to discover an ice palace. Yes, he's becoming Elsa. Maybe I like her aesthetic. Sue me. So now Jack has his official guardian lair with its own globe in the middle. He's amazed and he's looking around and then a note drops onto his head. The audience doesn't see the note, but we all know that it's from Pitch. Then we cut to the guardians on some sort of rooftop in a place where they fought Pitch before. Pitch finally shows up and he villain monologues at them. So even the guardians feel kind of bad about what they did to Pitch. But yeah, they end up fighting him. So this fight scene would be the most epic and pretty of the movie because all the guardians are sort of at their full power because so many kids believe in them. Eventually, the sleepover kids from earlier even come into the scene, and this is where it gets important. While fighting, one of the guardians destroys the platform on which the kids are standing and they begin to fall. Pitch immediately drops what he's doing and zooms over to the kids and saves them. In fact, Pitch is the one who gets damaged from the debris. The guardians walk over to him and the kids menacingly, but then they realize that the kids aren't moving. They're actually staying with Pitch. Jack stops and realizes that Pitch hasn't actually hurt a single child in the entire time he's known him. So he sides with him too, asking the guardians to spare Pitch. The guardians start talking to each other, with Jack trying to convince them to hear Pitch out and let him back into the group. Because fear is actually very important. It's not a pleasant thing to feel, but it's necessary to keep people safe. And if the guardians' main purpose was to protect children, then Pitch was totally in the right. He was always in the right. Obviously, Pitch has made some mistakes, and he's done bad things to the guardians. But the fact is, they need him, and they were the people who wronged him first. We see Pitch for a moment. He's on the ground watching the guardians talk to each other. The first person to approach him is Tooth. She hesitantly flies over to him. He snarls at her at first, but then she offers him her hand. He gets confused and takes it. In this scene, the moonlight would be directly on Pitch for effect, to show that the man in the moon is letting Pitch in. Tooth hovers back toward the guardians and lets Pitch's hand go. It cuts to an angle where you can see the guardians, but not Pitch. Tooth is like, why don't we ask him? And Bunny is like, fine, Pitch Black, do you want to be a guardian again? And he turns around and we see that Pitch Black is gone. They all look around. Jack blinks and looks down, which is when he sees the ring part of Pitch's headdress on the ground. Then, boom. Epilogue. Sort of a new day transition. Or a new century. The guardians are in Jack's home preparing for something, and they're all zooming around in different areas. Sort of like a parallel to how the guardians were working in the start of the movie. Jack realizes that he doesn't have his staff, and he asks around for it. Then boom, we hear Pitch's voice. Looking for this? Then Jack gets thrown his staff. Pitch enters in a new getup. I haven't drawn it yet, but maybe it's white. And the Guardians don't seem surprised to see him, because he's a part of them now. Pitch says something like, Jack, I'm always happy to pick up your staff for you after snow days, but I'd appreciate it if you cleaned up after yourself for once. And Jack, for example, might go, sorry, was my staff getting in the way of you and Sandy? And then Sandy sees something and he starts pointing upward. Eventually, he gets their attention and the Guardians look over at what he's pointing at, the hole in the ceiling that shows off the moon. The man in the moon brings out the whole Guardian choosing machine thing again, and the gang goes around it, excited for a new Guardian. And the last thing we hear is Jack going, so, who's it gonna be? And that's it. That's the movie. So yeah, it didn't come out perfectly. I don't know about the third act, but I'm happy enough with it. Sorry it took such a long time for me to put out. These videos can actually be kinda daunting for me to make, since I know so much planning has to go into a story like this. On top of the editing and the many sketches that I have to make. I kinda wanna go sort of regular art channel sometimes, like Alicia Nye and her tutorials, or Lavender Town and her little design videos. Of course, I'll be adding my own flavor to them, but they should take less time and be generally easier for me to make, with all the school stuff going on. As always, leave your critique in the comments if you have any. I actually have nothing more to say. So if you like this video, you're very cool and you're very awesome, and I'm making 49 statues in your honor. Subscribe and become a moon of Jupiter, I don't know. If you don't know, Elmushterri is the Arabic word for the planet Jupiter. But it also means the buyer, so like, I don't know, does that make you guys the sellers? I don't know, we'll figure it out. And if you didn't, then...